may be able to throw more light into this. This was introduced by a particular government. But where was it implemented? It was only implemented in the communist governments of LDF government of West Bengal and Kerala. These are the only two states where it was implemented. I'll give so many examples of that. What happened is that when our Paloli committee was appointed, what we did, the first thing we did is that we said that all Muslims should come under the ambit. Till that day in the state of Kerala, Urdu-speaking Muslims were exempted. They were called Dakkani Muslims, or they were called that Memmon Muslims. Two groups were there. That Sulaiman, certain group, they were the Memmon Muslims, and the others are Dakkani. They are called Dakkani. Dakkani is Urdu-speaking or Hyderabadi. They are usually Hyderabadi or Mysuri Muslims. They were excluded. We said that they are the most backward in the state of Kerala, and they have to be included. So they have been included. So that means in the as per the Sachar Commission report, everybody was included. Now, second thing in this Sachar Commission was that regarding the Arabic University. One of the recommendations we gave was that an Arabic University should be set up. Arabic University has been set up in the state of Kerala. Third thing was the Aligarh Muslim University's center. Surprisingly, again here, in Murshidabad in West Bengal and in Malappuram in Kerala only it has been implemented. Kishanganj in Bihar, they have started the work. In the Congress-ruled states, nowhere it was started. Aap, see, yeh aisa hai ki aap daawat pe bulayenge humko aur paani pila ke humko chod denge. Yeh problem hua tha. Humne poocha bhi nahi daawat ke liye. See, aap khud bulaya hame aur see, this is the situation which occurred as far as the Sachar Commission report was concerned. We didn't ask for it. It was brought, tabled within record time, accepted within record time, but not implemented. Implemented only in this case. Similarly, in the state of Kerala, first time minority commission was appointed as per the Sachar report. First time minorities ministry was set up there. Previously, there was no minorities ministry in the state of Kerala. Now, there is a full-fledged minorities ministry there with a separate minister in charge. So there is a minority. Then regarding this pre-matriculation, post-matriculation scholarship issue, you will not believe it. Pura India mein jitna scholarship hai, maximum scholarships have gone to Kerala. Aap dekhenge to, I think 50% of the entire pre- and post-matriculation scholarship scheme has been utilized by Kerala because it has been underutilized or lapsed in the states of Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, and many of the states of North India. So the scholarships which lapsed fell into the lap of the Keralaite Muslims and the Keralaite Christians. So they have taken the maximum advantage of this thing. So the Sachar Paloli report, we call it the Sachar Paloli report because the implementation was done by the Paloli committee. And there has not been a complaint either by the other, when the Congress government came to power again. It was brought about during the time of this thing. No complaint came. See, the Kerala government immediately within 3 months acquired more than 300 acres of land and set up such a campus like this Urdu University. The campus work is going on. We are not saying that it is full-fledged, but with all the earnestness, they have done it. So in the state of Kerala, the model implementation has occurred of the such. Nobody has complained. No Muslim has complained. Either from the LDF or the UDF. Nobody complained about the implementation of the Sachar. Nobody was creating trouble also about the Ranganath Mishra Commission report. See, because all these things have been covered from reservation to scholarships to Aligarh Muslim University to Minorities Affairs Ministry and all those things. And the Kundu report regarding the Dalit Muslim issue and the Ajlaf Ashrafi issue was not there in the state of Kerala. That has already been resolved. So that is as far as we are concerned, that was of very good. But should the Sachar implementation of the Sachar Commission report in the state of Kerala was fully implemented. Now we are coming to another important. I'm going through fast because there are other speakers. Now, what about minority status? If you ask me, there is nothing which has been abused so badly as the minority status in the state of India. You cannot blame the majority community for it. Because MES has fought so many cases for this. Recently, during the Modi government time, 2 months ago, the state government of Kerala refused to give us an increase of seats in the medical college from 100 to 200. They said that we will give you 200 seats only if you give 50% to the government. We went to the Supreme Court. Actually, we were sharing the seats. We were giving 50%. But we said we will only give through mutual agreement. We will not give you a permanent agreement. We will only give annual mutual agreement. The Kerala government refused. I don't know why they did it. It's a Congress government. They refused. We went to the Supreme Court. Narendra Modi was Prime Minister at that time. The BJP did not oppose it. See, you should understand one thing. The Bharatiya Janata Party is indulging in rhetoric. And it is, what should I say, the subaltern sections of that, or the subterranean sections of that, or the what should I say, the riffraff. They are doing so many things. But at the top, the part, they are not interfering with any of these things. They are not tampering with the minority status till now. Because I have the first-hand info, this thing, the experience with that. So what has happened in the state of Kerala, 3,560 or so institutions have got minority status. In the state of UP, only 1,700 have got, nearly only half. Only half have got that. Kerala's Muslim population is only probably 1/6 that of the UP population. But we have got double that. So that means we have utilized maximum the minority status. For example, MES has got 100 institutions having minority status there. So what does that mean? That means that we can appoint 100% of our students, we can appoint 100% staff, we can have the fees as per this thing, and even syllabus we can have. For example, in our institutions, sir, we are allowing the teaching of Arabic, we are allowing the Quranic studies, 1 hour is there every day, 1 hour Quranic studies. The other students are having moral science. There is no problem regarding that. So all our principals in the aided colleges, all of the principals we have appointed are Muslim. But as a concession to the secular state, we say that 65% of the staff, 60-65% should be Muslim, 30-35% should be non-Muslim. This is a principle which we are following. As far as the seat sharing is concerned, as minorities, that for the past 12 years, we have given 50% seats we have given to the state government. 50% we have given to the state government, but with one rider. This 50% we are giving is free seat, even in a medical college. The fees there is only 25,000 rupees per annum. Of course, this side the fees is very high, 5.5 lakhs. Here it is only 25,000. I put a condition. See, I am giving 50% to the government because I was negotiating at that time. As a private college management association president. So then I told the government, see, this is not fair. Our students pay 5.5 lakhs and your students are studying at 25,000. So we'll put a rider to this. Out of the 50 seats which we are giving to you, 15 seats should be from the Muslim community, which you will select. We will not select. Kyunki hum to ye kaane ka hamara purani aadat hai, samjhe. Aap log gus kehte shayad. I think it is called wo kaane ki aadat hum logon ko hai. So we don't want to get into this. So you send 15 poor students should be sent by the state government. Then 4 students will be sent by the OBC quota. 8% is so 50% means 4 students will come like that, 19. Then 3 to 4 will come in merit. So roughly 25 students out of 50 we send, 25 Muslim students will come, poor, the poorest of poor will come, and they will pay only 25,000 rupees salary. So that is what has been going on. The same thing applies to engineering also. There the fees will be only around 10,000 rupees or so. So this thing was going on. And that has been a big success. Now, why it's success? We don't want our students only to be from one community. It should be from all the communities. Yes, sir. I'll end. So this is one issue that we sorted out. Now, coming to the next, the self-finance. Now, what happened at the time of Siddiqui Saab? What has happened is that, unfortunately, many Muslim businessmen, they set up trusts. They set up trusts. These are all their own private trusts. They are aimed at minting money, and they are also aimed at laundering black money. The donations jo aata hai, wo black mein aata hai. So, wo trust bana ke, sab India mein jitne, if you take 100 Muslim institutions, sir, Kundu sahab, this you should note, out of 100 institutions, I can be pretty sure that 80% of these institutions are set up by private individuals only to make money, and they are totally misusing the minority status. What is the benefit to the common Muslim by this minority status? So there should be some inbuilt mechanism in this, that once you get a college or a university, there are private universities also, minority university. that university or college should see that a minimum number, I would suggest at least 30% of the students should be from the minority community, and that should be allotted by the state government, and the fee should be that of the state government fees. Then only there is a use in this minority status. Then only there is a use in this minority status. Otherwise, there is no fun in having any number of Khuda ke naam pe, Rasool ke naam pe, pata nahi, anzariyon ka naam par, you aap shuru karenge colleges. College mein wahi chalte, donation chalte rahenge. So that is one issue. Now coming back, I'm going fast. Then regarding the private capital. Sir, this, what has happened in this sector in Kerala state is that 60 engineering colleges were started, 9 medical colleges were started. The total Muslim investment in the state of Kerala in the state in education is more than 20,000 crores. But sir, now medical college bane to, you know, it will become 20,000, 60 engineering colleges. Now what has happened? The state government has got no control. They are giving NOC to left and right to anybody. So what has happened is that there is a total failure in the self-financing sector. Most of the engineering colleges are winding up. As they are wound up in the state of Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, there are no students. 60% of the seats are vacant in most of the colleges now. And most many of these colleges. Now the question is that the Muslim community in the state of Kerala has invested so much. Now that investment phat ho gaya. So that is a major issue. So economically, now we are facing a disaster. So that is one issue which, as far as the finance is concerned. Then regarding the role of NGOs, sir, I have a major complaint against the Muslims of outside Kerala. Sir, they are not doing any work, including Andhra Pradesh. See, kaumi taraf se aap log kya kar rahe hai? Aapka private investment hai, wo to theek hai. But what are you doing as a community? You are not doing anything. There are no NGOs. You name an NGO other than Alameen in Karnataka or MES in Kerala. A major NGO which is running, let us say, 10 institutions. There is no major NGO. And what our NGO is that, I'll give you an example. Kundusab, we are having more than 15,000 members. They have only contributed 1,000 rupees. Sir, my investment in MES is only 1,000 rupees. I don't get any dividend. It is a charitable institution as per the Charity Societies Act. Now, this sort of a NGO should be working all over India. I don't say that it should be MES. But similar NGOs should be set up in every state of Kerala. Then only we will be able to do something. So that means there's a failure of the NGO, this thing. Then we are coming to the political part of this thing. In the state of Kerala, I think Kerala is the only state where the Muslims have been given proportionate political representation. Kundusar, again, out of the total number of 140 MLAs in the state of Kerala, 33 if my memory is concerned, is Muslim, which means they have got exactly 25% of the cake. Out of 21 ministers, 6 are Muslim. That is also as per the cake. So that means political representation is being given properly in the state of Kerala. It is not that political, and in this Lok Sabha, I'll tell you, sir, I think there must be not only probably 8 or 10 Muslim MPs out of 500. So 5%. In Kerala, it is 25% population, 25% representation. So political representation is an issue. And finally, sir, I will come to one or two more points fast. I'm going very fast because Khwaja Sahib is signaling to me. So, but I have to end some, there should be a beginning. As in Telugu, they say, Andam Kadidi Arambam. It is not Arambam, it is Andam only. Okay, we are ending. So, so we are coming, finally we are coming to the women's, this thing. In the state of Kerala, sir, we are presenting a paper. Unfortunately, the person who came to the paper had a bereavement in the family, had to leave suddenly in the morning. I will present the paper instead in the afternoon on women's education, which I will present later. And only thing is that one point I will tell about the women's education. You will be surprised to know that at all levels, whether it's at the school level, whether at the collegiate, higher education, MBBS, MD, or dental, girls have swamped the boys. Kahi bhi nahi ladke. 62% of the posts in the higher education in the colleges are held by the women. Amongst the lecturers and amongst the teachers in MES, Muslims, 70% are held by women. So that means both the students and the teachers, the doctors, are all women. I'll present the doctor, Professor Amira's paper in the afternoon instead of her, because she suddenly left. I'll present that paper, and I'll make those things clear. So finally, I'm ending by putting it into the now. Till now, I've been all rosy. There are no thorns. Kaante nahi the. Sirf fool hi fool hai. Now we are coming to the flip bad side about it. Sachar Commission has found out that in spite of all these things, 25% Kerala Muslims are only occupying 10% of the government job. In the police, in Gujarat, Modi saab ke Gujarat mein, jahan 8% Musliman hai, 9% hai police mein. Police mein kya kar raha hai, wo alag baat hai. Samjhe. Kerala state mein 25% population mein only 10% are there in the police. Similarly, merit has been given a total go by. Ye jitne bhi kachra medical colleges banaya, kachra engineering colleges banaya, sab वो क्या क्या I don't know what you call जो अकलमंद नहीं है और जो बिल्कुल बेवकूफ है सब बेवकूफों का जमाना आ गया है केरला स्टेट में क्या है वो सब पूरे आप जो जितना भी मेडिकल कॉलेजेस हैं इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेजेस हैं सब लोग सब बेवकूफ खड़ा हुआ है समझे बिकॉज द सीट्स आर ऑल लाइंग वेकेंट एक्सेप्ट फॉर मेडिसिन सब सीट अवेलेबल है डेंटल सीट अवेलेबल है पैसा ज़्यादा मिल जाएगा इंजीनियरिंग सीट अवेलेबल है मिल जाएगा सो दैट इज़ अनदर थिंग सो मेरिट हैज़ बीन गिवन ए गो बाय देन What about the poor? We have entered into an agreement. Others are not entering into an agreement. They are all starting these institutions. Minority ka status pe institution khol rahe, donation le rahe. To gareeb log kahan jayenge? So this is a major question. Where will the poor go? Where will the poor amongst the Muslims go? They have no place to go. So that means the poor, brilliant, ebullient student is not getting a chance. This is a major issue which you have to ponder upon. Which the government committees, when they say, le lo aap bhai, Siddiqui saab dete hai, har ek ko dete hai, ye le lo aapko minority status. Minority status dene se kya fayda hai? Then another thing is that regarding this Gulf. This Gulf is turning out to be a very bad experience for us. Paisa to mil raha hai, lekin kya ho raha hai? SSLC, 10th standard mein, they are all dropouts. They are all going to the Gulf. Because I am one of the GCC appointed doctors. Fakhruddin and myself, we are the oldest doctors here. When he started here, I started in Kerala. Last time I have counted 10,000 people last year went from my center. Out of that, hardly 5,000 are graduates. That means the rest are dropouts. So they are going off. So whether the Gulf is doing any good to us, that is another issue. And finally, I am coming to that. Eventually, what is happening is that rampant commercialization is occurring. The whole thing, the education sector, jo hai, some pura commercialized ho raha. And indirectly it is becoming communalized also. Some communalization leading to commercialization. So this is the position, and so by presenting the best model, that is Kerala model, I think this model can be replicated, but with great difficulty all over India. On this note, I would like to end this my presentation over here. And once again, I thank Khwaja Sahab and Kundu Sahab for a patient hearing. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Professor Kundu, Dr. Zafur, my colleagues, delegates, ladies and gentlemen, I have intervened in the procedure which she has jotted down because I have to leave. Already we are very late. This session was to close by 11:45 or 12 o'clock. We are late. I am extremely sorry, sir, that I will miss your very interesting presentation. I know it was a very interesting presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, I am thankful to Dr. Kani Zahra and her department and her colleagues for organizing this seminar in collaboration with the Ministry of Minority Affairs, Government of India. And they have chosen a very eminent person like Professor Kundu, who was the chairman of the committee which reviewed the post such a situation. And the report is already available in public domain. And as Dr. Kapoor just pointed out, there has been write-up and pressure on the government to accept this report and implement it. Professor Kundu is the right person to talk about that. Thankful to Dr. Kapoor also for accepting our invitation and coming here and giving the experiences of Kerala. Why I'm saying so that in North India, where I come from, mostly people keep talking about that what is happening in South India as far as the minorities education is concerned, and nothing is happening in North India as compared to South India's model. I thought that he will explain to us the success story of Kerala, and which he has very eloquently and elaborately presented before us. My only point before this learned audience and the participants of the seminar is that whatever post such a situation is there, you can analyze. Data will be with you. Professor Kundu's report will be with you. But something which is, I think Dr. Fazal Ghafoor has also pointed out, I will also reiterate, something which requires attention for our side is there is a huge gap in our own management of our own affairs. And there is a huge, lot more to be done on that front. Not only in terms of the expansion or in terms of quantity, but definitely in terms of quality. So unless we perform well, unless we do much better than others, and whatever is available under such a committee or as a post-metric scholarship or pre-metric scholarship or any other thing, or a minority consolidated district development scheme, or Ministry of Education scheme, or FATMI committee report, and so on and so forth. It's our duty now to see that we perform well and we deliver results so that we can ask for more from the government and for the policy planners. There may be hiccups here, there may be hiccups there, there may be gaps here, there may be gaps there. Professor Kundu and others are the right person. I was expecting Mr. Harsh Mandir may also come today, but perhaps he was busy, could not come today. But Professor Kundu and these such eminent experts will talk about what are the gaps which should be filled up. But my point is, whatever is there, we should try to make maximum out of it and draw maximum out of it and deliver best performance out of it. And then only we can stand up on our feet, on our legs, and then stand up and look into the eyes of the policy planners that we can do this and we can do that. Please give us more and give us this and that. There's a lot to say on this issue on Muslim education and minorities education. We, of course, is not a minority institution. Maulana Azad National Urdu University is not a minority institution. It's a university like another university with the distinction that it has to teach, it has to have medium instruction in Urdu. That's all. But the benefit is going mostly benefit is going to the Muslim minority, because Urdu is by and large confined to Muslim minority, and we are getting a student. We are by and large from Muslim families and Muslim background. Now, therefore, I am saying that this university is an experiment by the government or by the policy planners, where through the medium of Urdu language, we can reach out to a Urdu-speaking community, which, in other words, by and large, a Muslim community. Now, if we perform well, if we deliver our results, if we have a good output, the benefit reaches to the desired target. A desired target or our target ultimately is Urdu-speaking people. So my point which I am arguing, whether it's Aligarh Muslim University or Maulana Azad National University or any other university or Jamia Millia Islamia, is our own management of our affairs. It's all our own management of our teaching system, and to deliver result, which is much more important than asking for more facilities and more things from post Sachar or post Kundu Kapoor or things like that. Whatever we have, whatever empowerment we have, we must at least show our performance there. And if we are not showing our performance there, I think we are not doing justice to the whatever is given to us. I want to talk more and more on this point, but I am sorry, sir, I have to leave. I take my permission to leave and my apologies to both of you. I wish I could have stayed longer and heard you and heard the audience question answer session, if any. Thank you very much, Kenny Zahra, and thank you much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sorry.
As a performance again. I think our keynote guest, Professor Amit Kundu, sir, his brief intro will be. Doesn't need any introduction, but for our students' benefits, let me tell us that he is an eminent social scientist, professor. At the center for the study of regional department development has been the dean of the School of Social Sciences at JNU, New Delhi, and a member of National Statistical Commission, He has done postdoctoral work as a senior Fulbright Fellow at the University of Pennsylvania and has been a visiting professor at international universities. He has undertaken international consultancies for UNDP, UNESCO, UNCHS, ILO, Government of Netherlands, University of Toronto, Saskava Foundations, etc. He has worked as director at various institutions such as National Institute of Urban Affairs, Indian Council of Social Science Research, and Gujarat Institute of Development Research. Currently, he is in the editorial board of Manpower Journal, Urban India, Journal of Educational Planning and Administration. He has about 25 books and 200 research articles published in India and abroad. I'll welcome you, sir, for keynote address.
Well, Gafoor, Professor Kaniz Zahra, Ms. Shabana Farheen, distinguished guests and participants of this national seminar. Gafoor sahab, you had a very intense listener during your presentation, and I'm sure I've taken down many of the points, and maybe we'll have some time to discuss some of the issues that you have raised in the context of the national report. Although I felt that you mixed up some of the recommendations of our committee with that of the UPA government's recommendation. Also, Gafoor sahab, with people who are less capable than you, you would allow them to speak in English, although I will also try to pick up some of this, a bit of explanation in Hindi or Urdu. I'm not really sure that I deserve this honor, privilege, love, and affection of the Maulana Azad National Urdu University. I'm not a social activist. I'm not a missionary. I'm an empiricist. I work with my statistical tools of analysis, but I'm impressed if an urologist could talk so competently on economic history of a region. I think also my statistics can take me to the areas, to the sociology of discrimination. I must tell you, it's my background in statistics which was responsible for my being the chairperson of the Committee for Diversity Index, which we proposed in 2008. We suggested that there has to be an assessment of the government departments, of the universities, of the public-private institutions, whether they're respecting the principle of diversity, which is not a matter of our weakness, it's a matter of our strength of this country. And the institutions which do not follow the principle of diversity in its employment policy or in terms of giving the benefits should not get the incentives or the subsidies to a certain extent, and there should be subject of, if they are continuously failing to meet in terms of the performance in diversity. That was the first committee recommendation. And again, I was asked to chair the post such a evaluation committee. We have submitted the report, although our committee was appointed by the UPA government, and Ranganathan and Sachar were great visionaries who had laid down the path for our committee's work, but we were in a somewhat difficult terrain. We submitted the report just before 4 months, and we have been told by the two ministers of the Ministry of Minority Affairs, whom I met personally along with my committee members, that they are considering it. It was discussed in the parliament. Given the latest trends in politics that we see this morning, I have a feeling that many of our recommendations will be taken up seriously, and I'm hopeful about that. Friends, let me talk about, the model of inclusive development. Sabka Vikas, Sabka Saath. As you know, I must tell you, I have been working in the area of discrimination, disparity, for the last 10 years or so, at least. And I would continue to do that work. I have a project from UNDP. After submitting my report to the government, and I'm hoping that something will come out of it, I'm again working on these similar problems of discrimination, not just because I have concern for the deprived sections of the population. It's because I'm worried about the fate of India. It is the inclusiveness of India which is at stake. And that's what we should be working together. It is the India's secular democratic basis which has to be protected. And that is the objective with which we have prepared our report. Let me talk about the vision of inclusive India. How do I operate this PowerPoint? Okay, you're doing it. 21st century belongs to India. This is a statement made. Just give the first one. Can the first slide remain? Yeah, thanks. This is my recent affiliations. After working for 46 years and teaching mathematical economics and statistics, I have now joined Institute for Human Development. As I mentioned, I'm working on the aspects of disparity and discrimination. Go to the first graph. The 21st century belongs to Asia, belongs to India. This is not a statement made by any enthusiastic Indian government official. It's Brookings Institution's projection. Just have a look at the bottom darkish graph. That is the share of China in the total global middle class market which China will provide. Can you imagine the share of India, which is about 2% or 3% now, is going to be 37% of the total global market which will come to India. India's per capita income today is just 35% of the global per capita income. Bharat ki jo vartaman prati vyakti aay hai, wo 35% hai global prati vyakti aay ki tulna mein. Lekin ADB ka projection hai ki Bharat varsh ki jo aay hai, the Indian per capita income will be something like 20% higher than the global per capita income by 2050. And growth rate of Indian economy has been twice that of the growth rate of the world because of the various crises. Lekin India ki jo growth rate hai, wo double hi rahegi 2040 tak, because hamare paas demographic dividend hai. Hamare 15 to 35 years in this age group, we have a larger percentage compared to Europe. Europe has a much higher dependency rate, which is a disadvantage. Indian youthful population is higher than even China, which is going to contribute to the significant growth that India is estimated to grow. And this is not the projection made by an Indian government official. It's a projection made by the Brookings Institution, ADB, and the World Bank. But there are certain buts. Are we going to achieve this growth scenario? Kya hum yahan pahunch payenge? Isme do crucial assumptions hain. Pehla assumption. Agar humne regional or social inequalities jo humare desh mein hain, agar usko humne address nahin kiya, if you do not address the social and regional inequalities, I have done the estimation, our total contribution will go down significantly. And in fact, this is a static model which I worked with. If you take the dynamic factors, it will be much less. Agar humne regional and social inequalities ko address nahin ki, our growth performance will be nowhere near what is being projected. Please go to the next one. Again, another assumption is that we have to make investment in skill development. Aapki youthful population to badh rahi hai. But are we putting them with the kind of skills which is required to take advantage of the global market? Agar aapne nahi kiya, aapki contribution aur ghat jayegi. So basically, these are the two critical things. Our social, religious groups ke inequalities ko address karna, regional inequalities ko address karna, and making adequate investment in skill development. And I thought both the issues are extremely important in the context of the present seminar. Let me start by looking at the inequalities. I would not talk about regional inequalities. I've done a lot of work. You can find it in the net. But I am presenting the social religious inequalities that we have, which is partly from our report, post-Sachar Evaluation Committee report, partly from my other work that I have done. Pehla graph dekhiye aap. Unfortunately, mere paas ek pointer nahi hai. Jo pehla block jo hai, wo rural ka hai. Dusra jo hai, metropolitan cities ka hai. Teesre chote shaharon ka hai. The last block is for urban. Ye latest data par hai. Kanish ji, you know, the data that you are quoting was up to 2008. This is for 2011-12. What do we find? We find rural consumption expenditure for the Muslims, which is, take the first block, which is for the rural. The third one from the right-hand side is for the Muslims. We have classified Muslims into two categories, OBC Muslims and non-OBC Muslims. OBC Muslims are having lower per capita consumption expenditure and higher poverty, but rural Muslims are doing slightly better than scheduled caste and scheduled tribe population. This is the national figure. Again, let me repeat that the rural Muslims report somewhat lower poverty compared to scheduled caste and scheduled tribe population, basically because Muslims are outside agriculture. Agriculture wages are less, marginal farmers, landless laborers. They have a lower level of, you know, consumption expenditure, but the rural Muslim consumption expenditure together is about 10% less than the rural average. Rural Hindus have, upper caste Hindus are much higher, and I think this is a point which was mentioned by Gafur Saab, that if you take the other minorities, which is six, Jains, Parsis, they have a much higher level of consumption expenditure. So when I talked to the Minister for Minority Affairs, Nazma ji, I did mention, this question was raised that how come your report is focusing on the Muslims only? Ministry of Minority Affairs, I did say, Ministry of Minority Affairs is not a Ministry of Statistics. They don't count only. They have to address the problems of the most depressed and backward minority. And that's where we find that the Muslim minorities are less in the rural areas compared to the average, but slightly better than the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe population. But look at the figures in the large cities and smaller towns. You find Muslims are less compared to even scheduled caste and scheduled tribe population. And this is something which is very, very worrying. You do find that the average consumption expenditure in the metropolitan cities, again, you know, it is third from the right-hand side, is less compared to the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe consumption expenditure also in the smaller towns. Please go to the next. I just wanted to quickly go over the whole presentation. You find this is the increase at constant prices between 2004-5 to 2011-12. The green, deep green, and the, you know, brownish ones, saffron ones, these are for the Muslims. In the rural areas, the improvement rate is much less than the average in terms of consumption expenditure. I would say they are similar compared to the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe population. Basically, what I'm saying is that the Muslims did benefit during the period of rural 2004 to 2011-12. This is the increase in the consumption expenditure per capita. But their Sachar Commission's implementation did not make an impact in the sense that the Muslims benefited more than the average. It is more or less similar, it is slightly less. The last pillar is for the average, but we find Muslims' benefits are less than the average, but it is similar to that of scheduled caste, scheduled tribe population. Go over the next two slides quickly. This is for the urban, million plus cities. You find Muslims benefited the least. Next one is again for the urban other centers. You find again Muslims benefited the least. So urban labor market, urban housing market, urban market for basic services have been discriminating, and certainly the benefits have not come to the Muslim population in the urban areas as much as to the other socially marginalized groups. Can we go quickly to the next one? Now this is coming to the main theme of the seminar. This is the school attendance rate 2004-5. And we have taken the data for 2011-12. The latest data, Dr. Zahra, is showing that the dropout rate starts at the age of 10 in the rural areas. You see, the dropout comes out. This is the school attendance rate from 5 to 24, but the curve which is at the bottom is for the Muslims, OBC Muslims. So the drop among the Muslim community, even in terms of dropout rate, is less. But as I said, dropout for both boys and girls is alarmingly high, much worse than as compared to scheduled caste and scheduled tribe population. We go to the next one. This is for 2011-12. Females, as I said, we updated the data. We do find that the girls are dropping out. They are also dropping out much more than the upper caste Hindus or other minorities like Sikhs and Christians and Parsis. But if you compare Muslim girls only with the Muslim boys, you find Muslim boys and Muslim girls more or less are dropping out at a similar rate, whereas gender inequality is high in other communities. Go to the next curve. This shows labor force. Do they get out of the school and do they go to labor market? Yes, indeed. As far as the boys are concerned, you find scheduled caste boys get out of the schools and go to the labor market. So do the Muslim boys. This is the both true for rural and urban areas. Let's go quickly to the next one, 11-12. Again, let me just, I will leave the graph with you, and you can also download. Some of these graphs are from our report. Our report shows that the Muslim boys are getting into the labor market at a very early age, just like the scheduled tribe population and also scheduled caste population, both in the rural and urban areas. But if you look at the female, the girls, can we go to the next one? You do.